All right, well, good evening. Welcome to night two of our week of prayer. And I am joined up here by Paul, Tyler, and Matthew. And so we're going to be sharing some more stories of our escapades into Africa. And, we're going to get straight into it. Paul, what's happening?
Okay, so the picture on the left, that was, we were at Milo, the parking lot, getting ready to leave. And the picture on the right, we're in the airport. I don't remember which one, but we're in the airport and I was reading a book in Pastor Tom found it interesting, so he took a picture of us and Hayden and I reading books. So yeah.
So proof to teachers that students can read physical books when not required to by class. And just Paul, for future reference, they're seen opposite. So your left is their right.
Oh, my bad.
So tell us a little bit about the travel there. So if you guys want to talk a little bit about the experience of going, leaving from Milo to the airport to actually getting to Africa itself. Any one of you guys that want to talk?
It was long.
It was long. Okay. Anything else?
When we were flying, we weren't all grouped together. So sometimes I think Matthew and I on the last flight were like 20 rows behind everybody else. There was this screaming baby half the time. I didn't sleep.
Yep. No, that's the fun parts of traveling. What about you, Paul? Did you make best friends with somebody you sat next to on the airplane?
Yes. So I met two Dutch dudes who were going to Tanzania to climb the Kilimanjaro. And then I met, I don't remember their names, but I met a lot of interesting people.
Yeah. Well, also, whenever you're traveling in airports, sometimes you get bored and you have some things to do. Matthew, what are you doing?
I learned the ukulele during our trip.
Now you're playing the ukulele, yeah. And trying to serenade Kylan, it looks like, right? Kylan, were you enjoying that ukulele in? Okay, Kylan gives a big thumbs up here. Also, you get a little tired when you're traveling, too, so you get to see a couple of these sleeping kids. Paul, you slept on the plane?
Yeah, on the car, too, on the car ride.
Well, that one looks like it's Matthew there falling asleep in the car, so was it a good nap? Well, we still got a little bit of a hum, guys. So what's happening here? Besides me failing at point fives. I had not quite learned the art of point fives at this point, guys. That comes later on in the trip. You'll teach me? I think I learned pretty well. We'll talk about that later.
So we were at Pizza Hut, and I did not know they had a Pizza Hut there. Very impressed. We were at Pizza Hut. We were eating. And it was actually pretty good. I enjoyed it.
So what did you guys do while you were there? Matthew, that's you there.
Well, I personally, the first day, we did a lot of windows, which all of us hated. But after that, I got to do a lot of painting, as you could see. It sucked, but it was also fun. The paint was really watered down because this construction guy really wanted to save some paint, I guess.
I think we talked about that a little bit both nights, that they actually took the paint and they watered the paint down a lot more than what we typically would here. Each one of the kids separated and did different jobs, and painting was the one that we probably did the most work on. And that's where, of course, you see Matthew there on your left hand side after cleaning up some of the paint at the end of a day. So. Well, Paul, what other work did you guys do?
So, Kaden and I, after doing the horrible windows, we decided to help out with reflooring a classroom. So we had to get the sand, transport them in buckets from like, it was kind of from here to maybe outside the church, get the sand. And then we had to get the water and all those things, the cement mix, and we had to manually mix the cement, I guess, the concrete. Yeah, cement. And they taught us how to do it, even though I think Kaden already knew. So we mixed it. It really hurts the back, actually. It's actually very hard. But after that, we started reflooring, and that room was filled with a bunch of stuff. And personally, I hate taking stuff out of rooms and just organizing those things. I hate doing that. But it turned out pretty well. We removed like maybe 35 desks or something, like the frame of the desks. We removed them. And then we were cleaning everything. And then apparently there were some rats running around. And I won't talk about no murder stories with Kylan, but just know things didn't go pretty for the rats. And so, yeah, some of us had fun killing the rats while others were running away. And yes.
So Paul, who ran away? Who was scared?
I just didn't want to go in. That's the truth.
And so Tyler, what do you got going on here?
Well, just to add on what Paul said, a couple of the African kids were throwing the rats at us.
Yeah, they were actually like threatening us with the rat and throwing it.
Yeah. Okay, so I was painting the line. I was actually making sure the line was straight because a couple of them didn't know how to, you know, have a straight line. Although the thing is about the paint, they were saying it was watered down earlier, so it didn't really matter too much.
Hold the mic a little closer to your mouth.
It didn't really matter much about the paint like dripping down or not, the line not being straight, because it was kind of the same color when it came out. So.
Well, on top of having working, it looks like you guys had a little bit of an opportunity to play some too. Matthew, what is happening in this picture of you and Kylan in the great outdoors? Maybe it looks like somewhere in Jurassic Park, or I mean, what are you guys doing?
It was a duel to the death. You see, like, we have this long rivalry since we've known each other, and just so you know, I'm better, but.
Well, if it was a duel to the death, both of you failed because you're both still here alive, thankfully. Glad that you guys stayed alive in doing that. Paul, what are you doing?
I'm just running. No, just kidding. So we had a soccer game with them, the kids. Kaden and I, we were in one team and Andrew was in another. And I was telling Kaden, like, bro, if they put Andrew in another team, I'm going to be so mad. And then they did that. But turned out to be pretty well. Sorry, Andrew, for your loss. But first game, they lost. But second game was a tie. I won't say why. But second game was a tie. And I won't say why. Yeah, they actually are very good. I would say if we played against them, maybe we would have won. Just maybe. What else? Okay, on the other picture, the one with those two girls, they were teaching me one of their dance. It's called the butterfly, and I will not perform it because I don't want to. Yes, I'm not good at this.
Yes. All right. So Matthew, it looks like you're in a couple of these again.
Yeah, I had to learn to kind of go out of my comfort zone and socialize.
Oh.
Socializing is a scary thing, but they love music, so when I came up with the guitar, they all wanted to learn. And I'm not a very good teacher, but it changed me, and it was fun.
Very cool. And at one point in time, I think I saw about 15 kids around Matthew when he was playing the guitar. And I'm like, how does he even breathe? Because they were all buddied up around him. I think we may have gotten, we may not get a picture in this one, but I'm not sure if we got a picture of that. Who are the, do you remember who these guys are that you took this wonderful picture with?
It's somewhere in here.
It's somewhere in there, Paul? You said you know?
So the two guys with Matthew is Micah, the one that Caden was talking about, and Jonas, the one who made the phone. And then the kid with us, and then like Matthew and I and Andrew, that kid, his name is Joseph.
Very cool. Very cool. Tyler, looks like you made a friend too.
Yeah, that would be Frank. Yeah, I think Amber also made friends with him too.
Oh, Amber also made a friend with Frank?
Yeah. I'm gonna be completely honest. Like, I acted like I heard their name, but I actually didn't. And I went through most of the trip not knowing their names. But that kid, he was really nice to me and helped me to know more about the school and how it works. And I told him about America and stuff. So
very cool, Paul. Who's your friend there with your, you know, big grinning face?
So his name is David, I think. I remember. So David, we have David, and then Micah again, Jonas, Joseph, and Godwin. And of course, I actually forgot the one right next to me that with that beautiful smile. I don't remember. He's wearing a black shirt. And he has a nice smile though. I don't remember his name.
All right, so what's going on here?
Okay. So they invited us for their graduation, and I loved it. The only thing, if I could change anything, was the fact that it was 5 hours long. So.
And 3 hours late.
Oh, and 3 hours late. So it was nice. I was very hungry. So when people asked me to film, my hands were shaking all around. So yeah. So in that tent, there was the staffs, Pastor Tom, Mrs. Alder, and Mr. Smith. They were the guest of honors, I think. And then on the other picture, it's those three girls. One of the middle one is the one that was actually graduating. The other two were helping her. And she did a dissection of a frog. So I know, trigger warning for biology. She opened that frog while it was still alive, and at the end of that dissection, the frog was still alive. So she was just like, she wanted to be a doctor, so she was like doing it. You killed the, you guys are doing dissections, okay? For biology, don't be sad.
Yeah, they went out and actually found the frog that morning. They didn't like get the ones in the package and all the packaging. They went out and, oh, we need to dissect the frog today. So they went out and found a frog.
So yeah, it was actually very impressive because she didn't kill the frog in the process. And yeah, there was other things like Jonas made a phone. Pastor Tom actually called him, and they kind of talked. And then other people, like also medicine related, they did something on like the effect of alcohol in your liver. They had a small liver. I don't know what living being it was from, but they had a small liver. And then they had.
It was a chicken.
Oh, okay. Good to know. Thank you. And then they had something related to salt or to find the chlorine content in water. So, yeah.
Yeah. And so they did. So part of this, they did a demonstration showing different health benefits. They also burned sugar because it's popular within some of the poorer cultures to make tea, that they would burn the sugar and then use that as tea. But that causes health issues. So they were explaining why to avoid tobacco, why to avoid alcohol, and they were showing all those things. And in when they were doing the dissection, they didn't just do a dissection, she actually practiced doing sutures and stitching the frog back together, which I don't know was overly helpful with it, but. All right. I'm actually curious on what's going on here, Paul. Why?
So, I don't know. I thought it was a good idea. Okay, so let's talk about the monkey. So we were in the safari, and I hope the others are going to talk about the safari. We're not going to touch too much on it. I just wanted to talk about this picture. We were passing by, going back, and we saw the sign no entry, and I saw this monk, this baboon looking at me. And the way he was sitting was so funny because it looks like he's going to the bathroom. But so, yeah, I took a picture and I guess he was fine with it because he was still looking at me afterwards. And yeah, on the other side, we went for, I guess, rest stop real quick or something like that. We did a quick stop at the arts convention or something. Mm-hmm. And it was very nice, like those beautiful things, like paintings and statues. And there was even a couple Jesus, huge statues, Jesus on the cross. And there was that crocodile. And I just saw, maybe I can put my head in there and let's take a picture. So, yeah.
So just in the future, I would not suggest putting your head into crocodiles or alligators' mouths. Learn from Paul's lesson here.
Yes.
He survived this one, but that's because it was metal. I wouldn't suggest doing that on the regular. Matthew, Tyler. Well, Tyler, what are you doing and why are you doing it?
Okay, so there was this place we visited. So, funny fact, our tour van survived, thankfully. But the other tour van, they got like two or three flat tires. One of the places we broke down was the village. I think it was the Maasai village or something. And their culture was to go up to a female and jump. And that's how you got a girlfriend. That's how you got a... Okay, I wasn't trying to get a girlfriend, okay? That's not what's happening here. But
he's jumping.
But I was jumping.
He is jumping. Ladies, are you impressed?
Trying to jump.
If you look at the guy behind me, he was a lot higher than me.
Yeah, so if you'll know... Yeah, they have quite a vertical... but they would go through this process in order to get a girlfriend. Whoever jumped the highest got the pick of the girlfriends. And so so that's the way, because it's a very patriarchal society. The women have very little rights. In fact, the only ones that can be girlfriends is somebody else's wives. And so that was your pool to pick from, was the guy's wives. They were your options for girlfriends. So very different culture than what we're used to. So Matthew, what are you about to do in here?
They were giving us a tour of their like little village, right? And I got to go to their little hut and go inside. It was like small. Like there's just a doorway and then there's just the bed. Like it was made of cow poop, which was fun.
So he said it was made out of cow dung. That's primarily that. Who built the huts?
Maasai. They did themselves.
Maasai did, but specifically which ones? Do you remember what they told us? Only the women were allowed to build the huts. The men were not allowed to build the huts. So that was part of the women's responsibility, as they were to build the huts. No. We'll refrain from that. All right, so which one of you guys want to talk about this?
Mombek.
Oh. Okay, Mombek.
Mombek. Okay, so he was a really cool guy. He was the principal of the school, and all the students were glad because he was a nice headmaster compared to some others. And that was the photo on your left would be our photo after the graduation, I think. And yeah, Mombek, the guy with everything is a 1 kilometer, you know, that guy.
So he was the headmaster, and our kids really liked him. We found out that the students there also really like him because he doesn't beat them. And it's actually quite popular for principals to beat their students with sticks. So also be very thankful that Mr. T does not employ those methods of discipline to start beating students with sticks. Though Dean Lambie looks like is a little disappointed that he cannot use that style sometimes. But yeah, it's quite common in several of these cultures where the headmaster of the school would use physical violence for disciplinary reasons, but Moonbeck does not believe in that, and he doesn't do that, and he's actually very well loved with that one. Very fun guy, but also no sense of time, distance, or anything like that, and the kids had a whole lot of fun with him. So, Matthew, where is this at? And it's a really nice looking picture with some beautiful friends.
This was when our tire blew up, like right beside the Maasai village, and which we didn't know till later. But we were there for a long, 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 long time, and there was a really pretty sunset. So we decided to take some pictures while Kylan and Caden were having a good 20-minute staring contest. I don't remember who won, but it missed out.
So on the way to one of our safari lodge, the tire blew out in one of the vehicles, and we ended up blowing the tire out and pulling over right at the Maasai village. That 2 days or the next day we'd actually come and visit. So it was kind of neat that we got a chance to meet them. And as soon as the tire blew out, they were all there helping to help pull the tire out. It wasn't just our drivers that got out and started pulling. I mean, they were all helping, moving stuff and stuff like that. So it was really kind of neat, that sense of camaraderie they had. So before we go on to the next pictures, I want to ask you guys, your interactions with each other. You guys obviously got a chance to spend some time. How do you feel about your guys' interactions with each other? Do you guys feel like you've grown closer to each other as friends? You guys, want to get away from them as fast as possible? Talk a little bit about your interactions with each other on the trip.
I loved it personally. I really like it. We got closer I talked to everybody, but I really got closer to people, to them. And got to know a little bit more about them and how they react under pressure and how they react under hot weather. So yeah.
Matthew, you had mentioned earlier that you got pushed outside of your comfort zone. What is that like, and how do you feel like you grew from that?
Well, like, if you're just gonna sit in the corner of the room and not talk to anyone, you're not gonna make any friends. So I kind of pushed myself to go out there and talk to people.
Are you glad that you did?
Yeah.
Very good. Tyler, what is going on? Why is your skin tone slightly different? What did you do differently that day?
It was not the hot water for the showers. So we went on the safari on Sunday and Monday, I think it was. And the first day was fine, and the second day was mostly fine, because there were covers on these things that we were riding in, except Caden and I sat on the back of the thing. I don't know. We weren't supposed to. We got yelled at later, but that's not the point. So we sat up there for an hour, and then I'm like, I'm not burned at all that night. My face was crispy. My arms were red.
And I don't know if you can see it in that picture. You can see this very distinct headline of where his hat was at. And then, Paul, you're with Amber. Where are you and Amber at this picture?
I think it's at the same time one of the students' favorite and least favorite subjects. You can see it. We were in front of the science classes, at least two of them. Biology, yay, and chemistry. Yay! So yeah, Amber and I decided to take a picture to just remind you guys of, how biology and chemistry are. Yes, it was nice. It looked really nice inside.
Tyler, wow. What do you got going on here?
My own slideshow, apparently. Wait. Oh, I was playing the drum. I didn't know they took that picture. Yeah, I was with a couple of the locals in the worship house for a bit, just playing the drums, did a couple flips for them. I don't know, just random stuff. We were talking for a bit. Apparently, they don't have gymnastics in Africa. It's sad. I don't know about that middle picture. Oh yeah, I made a bunch of friends there. I couldn't tell you any of their names, but I made a bunch of friends there, so that's the point. And then the upper right-hand corner, that picture is of that huge crater. That's the second day. It's Monday. It's the safari we went on where we saw the big five others, you know, the rhino and whatever. Yeah, there you go. And we had this shirt. It's a beautiful shirt. You probably got ripped off on. But there was a spot above the crater, and it overlooked the entire thing. It was just a very peaceful moment. It was a good moment. It was a good picture.
Paul, so every time in class, every time we have interactions, Paul says, stop, 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 we'll talk about it tonight. What lesson would you like to share with your fellow classmates that you learned in Africa?
The beans and the rice, they slap. When a man loves his chama, and then listen to the adults when they actually tell you something. So, for example, Pastor Tom told us to sleep. He told us not to sleep in the second flight where we're like leaving from Amsterdam to Tanzania, and I was like, man, I'm tired. So I was sleeping, and I don't know if it was that picture that he took. So I was dead asleep, and the next morning I woke up like 4 or 5 a.m. or something. It was tough. For the first couple of days, I kept on waking up at 5 a.m. And then another lesson he told us about, which most of you are wondering, is he said, hey guys, if you really want to buy something, please make sure that you talk to us first, so that we can actually figure out the real price of stuff and that you don't get ripped off. Well, guess what I did? I got ripped off. So, yeah, they were making fun of me because I'm from Congo and I'm the one that got the hardest hit, but it's fine. I rose from the odds slightly, yeah.
And so after Paul had paid American prices for something, and by American prices, just to give you guys an example of something that you could buy, they would sit there and say, well, let me, I think this thing is going to be worth about $12. And Paul's like, oh, $12, that sounds really good. And then he pays the $12. And then the next person comes over and gets the exact same thing for about 75 cents. So that's the lesson that Paul had learned. But by the end of it, Paul was actually negotiating even in the airport and getting some prices down in the airport. And he actually got one of the best deals there, maybe with a little bit of help. But
God bless Pastor Tom. So, yeah, I was trying to cook, you know, but you know what they say? Don't cook if you don't know how to cook. Don't cook alone, at least. Mm. And so I thought I was doing a good job because I was actually getting the price down at first, but the price were already so high, regardless of how far I got them down, it was still high. And so, yeah, we asked one of the natives there to help us at first, and then about a beautiful painting that some call my girlfriend, which she's not, but she is beautiful. And that painting was very... I really wanted that painting, and I even asked God for it. And the dude did not want to drop the price. And eventually, we finally got him to drop the price. And Pastor Tom helped me. But just remember, guys, please, just wait until the last days to buy a lot of things, because otherwise you're going to be broke. And don't get in debt unless if it's worth it, which it was.
I would be careful with that, Paul.
Depends.
We'll settle up later, though. From this trip, where did you guys, and I want each of you guys to answer this, where do you feel like you saw God on this trip? Matthew, let's start with you. And you have to hold the mic when you answer.
Let's see. I'm pretty sure they said this yesterday, but they just have a different kind of fellowship I've seen than I've seen anywhere else. Like, they're really bonded. They may not be related. They're like brothers and sisters. It's just really nice to see, and it's also what helped me step out of my comfort zone to see how they bonded, and like I sort of want that with others too. So that's why.
Tyler?
The music was where I saw it. So what they did for music was they all stood up. They didn't know they were singing. They didn't know what they were singing. And then this guy, I don't remember his name, Arnold, he stood up, he started clapping, everybody stood up, and then they started singing their hearts out, and they started beating the drum, and it was a little bit loud, but it was very nice. It was every single time they got to stand and sing, it's like they got up and they sung, and it was a blessing every single time. Even though they sang the same song, it was like Joy or something, they sang that song a lot. Every single time, it was different. It had its own, you know, effect every single time. And also, I don't know why, but we were flying. I know why we were flying, but I don't know why. But as we were flying down to Tanzania from Amsterdam, we flew over the Red Sea. And it was just kind of cool to look down and be like, Moses was there like 5,000 years ago. It was kind of cool. I don't know. It was just random. Mm-hmm.
Paul? So when we were in Africa, I asked all the kids this question as one of our devotional. And Paul asked to be last. And every time we went back to Paul, he always went back. So I gave Paul a little bit of extra time to think about it even more. So he should have had ample time to think about it.
Yeah, I got some time. Don't worry. Dr. Smith, really? Well, I mean, I also said another answer, but I will say it too. Dr. Smith, he took care of all the people that fell sick, because yes, some of us, including myself, even though I wasn't too much, we fell sick. We were having fevers, cough. Caden was pretending to not be sick. And you were sick, homie. Sorry. Dr. Smith really sacrificed a lot of time because he had to take care of the sick. He sacrificed, like, when we were going to some walks and stuff, like, sacrificed a lot of time to take care of, you know, each and every one of us. And if we felt like we were sick, he would, like, ask us how we are and stuff like that and check on us. So, yeah, him. And then just Janaea, how she was doing her candy ministry to all those kids. Like, we would have a bunch of candy and would be in a white van, and she would we would stop, and she would give candy to the kids, and no kids came in, but yes, we would give candy. She would give candy to the kids. Like, she gave probably like candy to over 50 kids or something. So it was really nice to see like the joy she had by just serving others and giving things to other people. So that was really nice. And just the people there, how much they wanted us to feel welcomed and loved. Mm.
What's one thing that you guys learned on this trip, either about yourself or just in general on the trip? Any one of you guys can answer.
I need to listen a little better to Pastor Tom, because he was talking to somebody. I don't remember who, but somebody was talking about the jet lag. I think it was Paul. He was saying that he was waking up at 5 a.m. On the way there, I had caffeine and I slept. I didn't sleep when I was told to sleep, and I didn't do everything as I was supposed to, and I ended up messing up my sleep schedule to the point where I was falling asleep at 7:30 to 8:30 at night and waking up at 3 a.m. And so I just needed, I need to listen a little better when I'm told to, because I'm not always right. I'm not an adult. I'm not, you know, yeah.
I also needed to listen so I won't get ripped off. What I learned about myself, though, is I love to bargain. So you will see me be cooking in those roads, hopefully with more money. Also, I learned I like to play drums, their drums. Yeah.
Matthew?
It's really practical, but I learned how to paint. It's not as easy as it looks. It gets everywhere. It drips. And it's, it could be hard to deal with sometimes.
Very good. Well, last question I want to ask you guys is, you have a lot of fellow students. Next year we'll be going on a mission trip again. We're planning on going to the Philippines for next year's mission trip. If somebody is considering going on the mission trip, what advice would you give them, whether it be about the mission trip itself? You guys have already said making sure you actually listen and read. You know, Caden advised actually reading the packing list and reading the materials. But what advice would you give somebody who is saying maybe they're not sure about being able to raise the money, or what advice would you give somebody who is considering going on a mission trip next year? And any one of you guys can answer.
Yeah, make sure you listen, please. Please make sure you listen. And get to know like what's respectful there too, because then you don't want to offend the people. And try to learn about like the actual price of things. Yeah, please don't make the same mistake.
I'm just going to reiterate what Caden said about actually reading the packing list and actually going by it. Because the only shoes that I brought to Africa were my Air Force Ones. I was working in them. I was walking in them. Don't bring your extra shoes. Look at the packing list.
Matthew?
Don't be afraid, like, it's a mission trip. It's there to change you and to help others, and you should take the opportunity.
You guys have any closing words?
Appreciate what you have for dating in Milo, because you weren't allowed to date until you were 23, and their parents and the people in the school were allowed to beat you, not to death, but basically to death, if you were caught doing anything worse than talking.
Okay.
To build on what he said, not about the dating. not about the dating. Appreciate what you have, because those people were one of the happiest people I ever saw in my life, and they had y'all's are like billionaires compared to them. In their eyes, y'all's are like super rich, you know, you have the Bugattis and all of those nice fancy stuff. So really appreciate what you have. Joy is not in paintings or, you know, things that you actually like. Joy, it's you make joy, you know, it's a choice. It's a choice to be happy. So appreciate what you have. And if you be passionate about what you want to do, because like Jonas, he made a phone, and his degree, he was studying to be a doctor. It's like there's no relationship between those two things. He made a phone, he studied about chemistry and biology and stuff like that. So if you're passionate about something, if you're passionate about something, don't wait, just do it. Find things that can help you achieve it, because you don't really need to depend on anybody. You can do it if you really are passionate about something. Yes.
Anything, Matthew?
Well, you should be flexible because sometimes they don't have what you're usually used to. Like there wasn't always hot water, and then they didn't always have toilet paper. And the food.
All right, well, tomorrow night we will have Andrew and Kylan will be sharing with us. And so, yeah. But just want to say thank you guys for getting up here. For some people, getting up here is not as easy as it is for other people. Some people can get up here and talk. Others, it's a lot more difficult. So when you see these guys, and as well as Amber and Caden last night, just let them know that you appreciate them sharing. And we're going to close with prayer, and then we'll be back tomorrow night for night three, talking about some more stories from Tanzania. So let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, I just want to thank you for the opportunity for us to go to Africa, for the opportunity to visit Tanzania, to work with the Lorgerke School, Lord, and to be able to see a different pace of life, to see how things are different there. It's shown us to be more appreciative of the things that we do have, even things like running water, power, internet, all these different things that we have, Lord. We feel sometimes limited here, but it's significantly limited there. We thank you for that. We help you, you pray that you'll help us to listen, to be able to follow you, and to ultimately be a blessing for those that we go to serve. And now that we're back here, help each one of us to serve. And for those that didn't go, there's somebody here, Lord, that you're putting on their heart to go next year for the mission trip. I pray that you will remove their stress and anxiety, Lord, that you'll help them with the biggest hurdle, which is the biggest hurdle up front is the fundraising. I pray that you'll guide and direct in that. Be with us the rest of this night, and go with us as we go back to our rooms. In Jesus' name, amen.